Today, this reading is where we see what I would describe as the most emotionally intense moment in all of history. And you know, if we walked through the Gospels and if we got to this point, and both Matthew, Mark, and Luke also describes this account, and if we were to move from the Last Supper to the betrayal of Christ by Judas, this scene in the Garden of Gethsemane does not offer any type of redemption that's necessarily necessary for the work of Christ to be applied to the church. And so, in other words, we don't see here this moment that is a necessary act from Jesus that our salvation is applied from. However, the gospel writers saw this as an important thing to tell the church, to tell God's people about. This is an account that is given by both Matthew and Mark, and Luke, in fact. And so we see this in the Gospels. There's a reason that this account is here, this description of this time when Jesus is being distressed and wrestling in prayer. So I want us to see, because we do see the heart of Christ here, and I want us to see that seeing the heart of Christ helps us see and deal with our own hearts. And I believe anytime we get to see the heart of another person, really look into their being, and as they expose who they really are, one, we get to know them better, actually see how they respond, but also we get to consider how would we respond in a situation like this. What would our reaction be, or how would this make us feel? And so as we see Jesus here in all of his divinity and all of his humanity, we recognize this is the real Jesus. But I also hope this can help us see and deal with our own hearts, considering the way that this is applied to us. So the first point I want us to see, the first of three, is to look at the distress of the eternal Son of God in the garden. Now, I don't know where everyone here falls on the scale of appreciating this or really struggling with this scene, with what we see here. Because what we see is we're presented with vulnerability. We see here what we may call second guessing by the Son of God. We may be looking at this and seeing the eternal Son of God looking to see if there's an alternative path for him. Some of this phrasing that we read in these verses is identifiable with much of the downcast writings of the Psalms. Luke even tells us, when he describes this, that the sweat of Jesus was like drops of blood. Now, as we consider these descriptions of agony, as we see a troubled spirit, as we see the distress here, as we see an expression of this desire for a different or an alternative outcome, I want us to be reminded of the theology of the second person of the Trinity, God the Son, Jesus, here in the garden as we see him in these moments. This person in Gethsemane, being fully God, is the same in substance, equal in power and glory with the Father. And thus, the question for us is that as Jesus comes into the garden and begins to pray to the Father, does he, for these moments, cease being God, based on his questions, the descriptions of what he's going through? Does he cease being God or cease being fully God even for these few moments? As he's asking for something different, as he's expressing some uncertainties, what's happening here? And it's important that as we read about this historic account that we're able to emphatically say, no, Jesus never stopped being God, and he never stopped being fully God in these moments. And these reactions to what was coming, to what Jesus was facing, show us that God the Son, who became human, the one who, according to John, was there in the beginning, the one who, according to Paul in the book of Colossians, by whom all things were made, as our Nicene Creed puts it, Christ, very God of very God, looked upon what was happening, seeing the hour that had come, and he could hardly bear it no more. Eternal Son of God, equal in power, glory, same in substance with the Father, this is how we see him here. Now, a sermon like this cannot properly explain what we're reading here. And there's no list of adjectives, adverbs, any type of terminology that I could use or that any author could attempt to use to try to adequately take us into the heart and mind of Christ in this moment. But may we at least see that the coming death of Christ, that what he was experiencing in these moments caused the one who will reign forever to have uncertainty and to have fear. Matthew, Mark, and Luke thought this scene was important enough for us to get a glimpse into the heart and mind of the one who will reign forever as he's going through these uncertainties and fears. Now, I remember as a child, as I'm being exposed to the story of Christ every time as a child, I'm always wanting the story to turn out differently, scenes to look different. I'm always wanting to see Jesus take control of these situations, to express his divinity by pulling out some type of magic sword, or at least to see maybe arrows fall from heaven onto the Roman guards, showing that they're messing with the wrong person. Jesus, use your eternal power here. Make this different. Don't just let them have their way with you. Now, we usually have fairly consistent responses to being distressed or afraid or attacked or feeling abandoned. Oftentimes, those are moments where we feel very out of control, and so our reaction is to attempt to regain some of the control that we feel like we have lost. To look for some type of avenue where we can chart a better course, where we could gain some type of new footing, where we could have some semblance of stability when we feel like we've lost control, or when we feel like something has gotten out of what we can grasp onto. Some of us may even shut down, refuse to face the situation because we can't bear to face our limitations in those moments. But here we see the one who has the power to order all things. And what he does is he goes and he prays to the Father. The one who has the power to put everything in place exactly how he would want to do that. And what he does is he goes and he prays, unveiling his heart. And we even see the way that he repeats this process multiple times, even as his followers abandon him to sleeping. He sees that they're not doing as he has asked, and then we see that he repeats this process, unveiling his heart to the Father, praying in distress to the Father. But we, we who are not God, we who are not divine in this way, we so often reach for that godlike power of gaining control. Things feel out of control, first reaction, let's find some sense of control. Those of us who are not like God, that's what we do. But Jesus, who is God, very God of very God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but instead emptied himself, saying, "Not my will, but your will be done." This coming from the mouth of the one who has the power to order all things, to gain complete control in a moment, emptied himself. "Not my will, but your will be done." This is to show us, as Matthew, Mark, and Luke all wanted us to see, this is to show us that Jesus did not submit to the Father's will simply because he was God. He did it because even in the weakness of his flesh, his humanity, he, being filled with the Holy Spirit, sought the Father's will even to his earthly detriment. Experiencing all of the distress that he was going through, recognizing his humanity, without sin, in his pain, and in the suffering that had already begun, by the power of the Spirit, pursues the will of the Father. Now, a couple of things about this that I want us to see as we close out this first point. The first one is this. God does not call us to be slow to think or slow to act, slow to plan. God often calls us to make decisions and to be decisive in what's coming next. But most of our energy and our first efforts as God's people should be to go and pray. Most of our energy should go to that. That should be first response. Most of our being and hope for the future should be directed towards prayer. Decision-making will follow, but we have to give all that we can to make sure that God is aligning our hearts with his. And this is what Jesus is doing. This isn't a call to be lazy or to fail to plan, fail to make decisions. But this is saying most of our energy must go to this place where Jesus is going. Decisions will follow. The second thing I want us to see is that being able to discern God's will for our life, especially when it initially causes us to suffer, or especially when it causes us to have to face something that we don't want to face, our ability to do that can only come through Spirit-seeking prayer. This is not something that we're going to do otherwise. We're going to seek the other route every time. The route around suffering, the route around anything that will cause pain or hardship, we're going to look to go around that unless we begin the process by Spirit-seeking prayer, looking to be aligned with the Lord. I think we really fool ourselves into thinking that we can pursue God's will, find ourselves carrying out our God-given purposes, walking in the Spirit, when refusing to put our energies into prayer and seeking the Spirit of God. We really see this in this example that Jesus has given us. The second thing I want us to go to is the coming to the grips with the wrath coming to grips with the wrath of God. And one thing we have to see here about the Garden of Gethsemane is that we have account after account of followers of Jesus that died to us what may seem a more confident death. We are told, church history tells us this, that Polycarp, who was an early second century bishop of Smyrna, he was, from all that we can tell, a disciple of the Apostle John, sitting at the Apostle John's feet, very likely ordained by the Apostle John to lead the work of the church in Smyrna. Late in his life, after refusing to denounce the kingship of Christ, Polycarp was threatened with death by being burned at the stake. And we're told that his response to this threat was, "Do what you will." And then he, while being tied to the stake, this is what's recorded that he said, "I bless you, Father, for judging me worthy of this hour, so that in the company of the martyrs I may share the cup of Christ." This is what Polycarp is recorded as saying as he is being tied to the stake, ready to be burned. And throughout church history, we see this pattern over and over again. Christians preaching the glory of Christ, singing the hymns of the church as they're led to the guillotine, or as they're being burned and consumed by flames. And we see Jesus here in the garden, struggling with what's coming, distressed, in tears. And the way to understand this is to know that in these moments that we read here, we have to see that Jesus began to face something that was much worse than his martyred followers ever had to face. The cup that he was beginning to drink, the cup that was already coming, was not simply a cup of a brutal and inhumane death. It was a cup of God's wrath, his fury even. And Jesus is beginning to taste the utter depravities of hell. This is not Jesus fearing the lashings that would come because he knew lashings would come. This is not Jesus fearing the thorns and the nails that were awaiting him because he knew those thorns and nails were awaiting him. This is Jesus beginning to experience an existence without the love and the presence and the breath and the word, and the life and the light of God. This is what was coming into who he was. And I believe that what we are shown here, that while followers of Christ have been time and time again given the strength and the dignity to die for the name of Christ, God himself here was face down in sweat and in tears as he was facing not heaven, but he was being given hell. Not the face of God, but the actual disappearance of God. So what's happening to Jesus in the garden? I believe it's necessary to mention, one, it's necessary to know this is what Jesus was facing, but also, as we come across a subject like this, to deal with the fact, this is difficult to come to grips with God's wrath. It's often denied and often dismissed in favor of love and grace. So I want to just mention it this way. The Bible never dismisses God's wrath. I think, one, we see it here, but also we see it described clearly in other places. We even see it mentioned after the cross of Christ, the wrath of God, the cup of his wrath. We see God's displeasure mentioned, his anger. But I want us to realize that this is a clear extension of God's goodness, his character, his justice. Now I want you for a moment to think through the times when some of your angriest times, when you found yourself the angriest that you could be. And this is not to justify your anger, but I want you to think about your angriest moments. What were the cause of those angry moments? Now, when I think through mine, and I think through what I was feeling, what generated it, why I may have lashed out, why I may have been in such a state, it's when someone that I have deeply loved, someone that I deeply care about, has been badly hurt or badly mistreated. Now, here's a way to cure anger. If you're struggling with some anger in your life, just stop loving people. Don't love anymore. Never love. Never care about yourself or another, and you won't have to worry about being angry. So often our anger is a result of that very thing. Now, God, because of his great love, he tells us he will punish sin. And for those of you who find yourself in Christ, what we're told is that your punishment has been borne on the cross of Christ as God poured out his fury, his anger, his wrath on sin. Your sin, my sin, as Jesus chose to take it on to then face that very thing that Polycarp didn't have to face, that the apostles didn't have to face, you and I will not have to face because of the faithfulness of Christ. And I want to close with this point, filling the gap, number three. And what we often find, actually I think what we're all dealing with probably today, is that we have our will, your will, and then we have God's will over here, and then we have this gap in between our will, God's will, our desires, God's desires, the things that we want for our life and the things that God wants for our life. There's this chasm. Now, where we can often find ourselves when we're facing this gap, and we know that we have to go from here to here according to God's word and his plan for us, we often detach ourselves from the Lord. And we do this in order to pursue our desires. And the reason we do that is because it's no fun to pursue our desires when they're this way. God's desires are this way. It's no fun to do that if we remain attached to the Lord, because conviction comes and the leading of the Spirit, the calling for us to move direction. So we detach ourselves from what may be tugging at our hearts and what may be speaking to our minds. Those scriptures that we have learned and that we know, we remove ourselves from that. And what we see here in the garden is we see Jesus filling in this gap with God's presence. And you see here, we see the Son of God expressing the desire for an alternative route. God, all things are possible with you. If there's another way, bring it. We don't see him detaching himself from the Father. Nor does he squelch what's in his heart. I think this is a beautiful thing for us to see. Jesus instead reveals his whole self here. He asks that he would be aligned with the Father. And then regardless of the difficulty of what's going on, he longs for this gap to be filled in with God's presence so that he could be led to the right place. As a result, Jesus voluntarily enters into this suffering. So the garden is a pivotal moment in all of history where Jesus willingly enters in to this suffering that is coming. So what we have here is our Christ, person who Paul refers to as the second Adam. So we have Christ, the second Adam, entering into this second garden, if you will. So we have the second Adam in the second garden. Now in the first garden, God told the first Adam, obey me and you will live. And in the first garden, there was disobedience and we all died. There was a death in the first garden. Now in the second garden, God told Jesus, the second Adam, our representative, obey me and you will die. Jesus obeyed, and we lived. Adam, through his disobedience, brought death. Jesus, through his obedience, brings life. Now, have you ever wondered if God has abandoned you? Have you ever wondered, has he misplaced your file? Have you ever wondered if he's forgotten you, turned his back on you? I want us to see that what happens here, what we have heard, what has been read to us today, tells us that the Father abandoned the Son so that you would never be abandoned. If you ever wonder if God has abandoned you, come back to this place. And remember that Jesus was abandoned in the garden, following his obedience, so that we would never be abandoned despite our disobedience. This is the gospel. This is the gospel that saves. By Jesus' death, our death is overcome. We've been given new life. May we be able to seek the will of God because Jesus longed for the will of God to be fulfilled. Let's pray. Father, may we see that the very cup that our Lord began to drink started here. He started experiencing my sin, our sin, in those moments. And then I pray that we see, even as he began to drink this cup of horror and death and your wrath in these moments, that he didn't put the cup down until he was finished. Father, we thank you for being willing to give this cup to your only begotten Son so that we may be granted adoption into your family. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.